morning, I want to talk a little bit about the stylized VFX in Rhyme. And I'm Simon, and I'm a freelance 3D and VFX artist. And just to mention, I have this blog where I write about game art tricks, and there you will find the talk later recorded, hopefully, if all the cameras and sound are working. And just if you miss some details or if you rewatch it again or need some more. And I will also add more details, like, for example, some Unreal Material Network thingies if you want to have a closer look and stuff like that. So don't worry, it's not you don't have to take notes here, right? So let's see. I took some notes. Where's my thing? Did someone already see this talk in the past? Oh, okay. Good. Good news to you. I changed it a little bit, so it's not a totally boring repetition from last year. Most of the effects I'm talking about are not done by me. Basically, nothing is done by me. I just talk about it because I think it's awesome. And yeah, you can find it on the blog. Yeah, and since I investigated this stuff when I saw it, right, and didn't make it myself, it might be that when we have later some questions and answers, that I can't give every answer, but I don't know. I hope maybe I can ask the people who actually did the effects, and then we can work this out. Okay, but let's talk about what we want to talk about today. So in the original talk, I was talking about this little fire, stylized fire, this little stylized smoke, and this little stylized waterfall. For this talk, I changed a little bit. So there will be a light version of the first two. We will still talk about it, but with a little less details. And if you want to know more, then you should maybe go to the video on YouTube and watch the talk from last year. And the waterfall, the only effect where I contributed to was gun in exchange for the water. Because when I was doing the talk afterwards, many people came like, oh yeah, it's nice, but how was the water done? And I was like, I have no idea. So I decided to put this in. So let's have a look on Rhyme. This is Rhyme, if you don't know it. It's a really beautiful, really friendly game, and it looks really nice, at least in my eyes. And it's, as you can see, pretty stylized and comic-ish. And of course, such a game needs some stylized VFX, right? So I would like to talk about this little fire, which I saw first, which I showed already. And this is how it looks in game. Personally, I thought when I saw it first I thought, oh, that looks nice. And the second thought was, oh, maybe it's a flipbook. That's how some people would do it, right? Just use a flipbook and then play it and play it and play it. Then I looked at the textures, which are driving the effect, and they look like this. Really? I was a little bit surprised when I saw this. I mean, how is this making up this really cool-looking fire? So we have this little rainbow texture on the left, and here we have this little foam thing. It gets a little bit clearer, even not that clear, but a little bit clearer when we look at these textures channel by channel. So we see we have some masks there, right? And here it's some foamy structure, and this is other foam structure. So it's just some interesting noise. And the base foundation of this effect is moving UVs. And just in case you don't know what I'm talking about, you can move the UVs of a mesh, for example, and it looks then like they scroll along the surface, right? But you don't have to move the UVs by one constant parameter and apply this parameter, which drives them to move them along. You can use, for example, an texture so that the UVs are moved still, but not all the UVs are driven by the same parameter, right? You get this noise, and then it gets way more interesting, right? Here, it almost looks like water distorting the surface of some tiles or something. It's way more interesting, right? And this is the basic foundation of this effect. But what actually happens is our interesting foam structures from before are scrolling, and on top of each other, they are added together, and it's a little bit hard to see, but they are actually added together and scroll with different speeds. And then they are masked out by the other masks you saw in the other channels of this first rainbow little texture. And this drives basically the UV distortion. Right? It makes sure that in the outer areas nothing is wobbled around, and this gets added to the UVs. And the UV you see there, this is basically the standard UV space, right? From 0 to 1, represented as color, nothing special to it. And then these information, these scrolling and animated information get added. And when you apply this as the UVs to your little rainbow texture from before, it looks like this. And this looks more like what we expected, right? Now it gets somewhere. Still not really fire-ish, right? It's, I don't know, the colors are a bit off. But it gets more clear when you look at the channel in separated way, because then you see that the red channel contains the inner fire and the green channel contains the outer fire, and with that you are able to colorize both however you want. Actually we did this. There's some reddish fire and some bluish fire and whatever you need in the game. That's the fire effect. Yeah, pretty simple if you know how it works. And it was done by David Miranda. Like I said, I didn't do this, but I like to investigate these things and have a look on them and being amazed by it. And then talking about them, that other people can be amazed by it as well. It's really nice. When I did this talk, some other people recreated this fire, and I posted their results on my blog. It's really, really nice to see what these people came up with. So the next little effect I would like to talk about is the smoke. Usually, when you have smoke, it's soft alpha blobs which fade away or something, right? Here, for example, is a really nice example from Diablo 3. Really like this one, and I can recommend to watch this talk. When you Google it, Technical Artist Bootcamp, the VFX of Diablo, it's free to watch, and it's amazing. It's one of the best talks ever. And they have this little smoke, but this, it looks really nice, but it doesn't fit to Rhyme, for example, right? We need something more stylized. And there are interesting examples on Twitter where some people use geometry, a lot of geometry, right, in combination with some nice shading, and they drive some really nice smoke with that. And this looks more like what we want, right? This looks more like in an anime movie. I have another example. In Super Mario, you can also see these little smoke puffs, which are actually also geometry and just scaling down for the fade-out effect, and works perfectly fine, right? This is the foundation for the smoke. The basis and the idea comes from Felix Menendez, and you see we use it everywhere in the game. Everywhere we have some little smoke puffs when something happens, and there even with the burning things. So this is the basic idea. Even though on the burning things there is a little lookup texture which makes the smoke glowing hot at the bottom when the geometry particle starts and then turns to black, but the basic idea is the same. So what is this basic idea? When you use a standard sphere for it, then you have the problem that here at the poles you have a lot of geometry, a lot of vertices. The geometry density is a little bit higher, and so it's not evenly distributed. And so what we wanted is, we took this sphere and added the spherify modifier from 3D Studio Max, and just make a sphere out of the box. And with that, you get a more evenly distributed geometry on your little sphere. Because it's important, because we will push it around a little bit with vertex shader, and then it just looks better. And I think after the talk, someone asked me, why don't you use this iosphere, geosphere? I don't know, this sphere which only consists of triangles, right? And my answer was, that's a good idea, actually. that's old slides, right? And then we add a spherical mapping to it, like remapping spherical, nothing special. And that's the basis for our little noise pattern, which we will add later. So, and then we just add a color, so that's easy. But the shading is a little bit hard, right? It's a little bit too dark. We want to have something more like this, and we fake it by adding some emissive values. So basically, the thing is self-glowing, which can be a little bit problematic, but we will come to this later, because you don't want your smoke glowing in the night, right? But in a certain light condition, it's okay. So our smoke got optimized a little bit with that. Then we deform it a little bit with some noise pattern, just some vertex offset. And then we use alpha erosion to fade it out. And this drives the effect, right? Everything else before is just basically a sphere, but this is most important. And just in case you don't know what alpha erosion is, imagine we have a little black and white pattern like this, a little noise, and we imagine these values as height values, so that the white ones are high and the black ones are low, like a mountain thing. And then you cut away everything below a certain threshold, and then it looks like this. And basically, this is exactly what happens. We use an alpha 1, or masked. In Unreal terms, it's called masked blend mode. So pixels can be there or can be not there. And the shader decides below a certain threshold, he doesn't show anything. And this is basically what happens, right? We reduce the brightness of this pattern, and with that, we fade out the smoke. Like I said, we, in WIME, in the first level at least, you have a day and night cycle. So you don't want to have glowing smoke in the night. And luckily, the Unreal Engine has these material collections. Is it correct? Yeah, material collections, right? Which can be fed by the code. And we feed in these material collections the current intensity of the day and the current color of the day, light. And then we can use this in the material of the smoke. And with that, adapt it to any light situation. Because the other option would be that you create for, I don't know, these six situations, different particle effects or something with different colors, and you don't want to do this. Right? So I guess what you can take away here is if you fake stuff, you need to have more control, because these, to get the shading right, this is basically a little fake with the emissive color, right? But therefore, we have to have more control about the colors later. Yeah. Okay, so this was the light versions for the first two effects. Like I said, more details in the other talk. I have more slides and more GIFs and stuff like that, but this is the basic idea for it. And now we can talk about water. Water. So, okay, this is Pablo. Pablo made the water. And I think I should say something now. I'll say it later. I say it later. So this is Pablo, like I said, and this is the water of WIME. Looks really nice. And here it is in motion. It's just a GIF, so the quality is not perfect, but you get the idea, right? There's some moving stuff, there's some refraction going on, some little reflection speckles and all that stuff. When people came to me and said, hey, how is the water made? I was like, I guess it's something like this, right? You have a plane, little lower opacity, that's your water, and then via depth fade, you fade it out so that it doesn't interfere with the, intersect with the ground, right, with your bases. And also with the depth fade, you can colorize it a little bit. It's not, the colors are a bit dark, but here's a bit more greenish and here's a bit more bluish, right? So roughly like that, that was my assumption. And then I said, in case you don't know what that, no, this is not an alien shooting a laser on mountains. This is a guy looking into the water. And depth fade is basically that, depending on the distance of two surfaces, you get a different value between 0 and 1. And with that, you can make something like this, right? That the water fades out because it gets more to 0, and you use this as opacity. And then you fade it out, and then you don't have hard intersections, or I can use it for changing the color depending on the water, on the surfaces differences. So this was my assumption, okay? This is my material, and it's a bit of a shame that I told that to people because it was a little bit wrong. Let's look at the material, how it looked like. So I was slightly off with my assumptions. Slightly. Okay, so let's look at what makes this water waterish. First, I will talk about some basics, and then we have some nice caustics, right? So on the ground, below the water, you have these nice little caustics. Then you have wet sand. So you see this, right? The sand gets a little bit wet and then dries out again. It's really nice detail. Then, of course, the water gets a little pushed around to make it wavy. Then we have some, the color, important part, of course. We have some reflections and some fake reflections and some refractions. And we will talk about all of this now. And we will start with some basics, just some basic fundamentals about water. So this is called a pizza. They called it like that, or Pablo called it like that. So this is a disc shape, and every of these pieces is a separate object. And this, maybe it's from, if you saw the Fortnite talk, this may be familiar to it. They do something similar with the sky, because this helps you with two things. First, when you don't look one of the pieces, they can cull it away, so you don't need to care about it, right? And the second thing is, in the distance, for example, you don't need to push around the vertices, you don't see it anyway. You can use cheaper shaders or materials in the distance. So this is really, really nice. So the pizza, and the pizza, this is manually created. It's not tessellated in real time, but it just makes sure these areas are further away from the player. You know that. Right? We made sure that the player never can swim far, so you don't need that much of geometry information in the distance. So this is how these pieces are built. And almost all of the calculations in the material are based on vertices. I don't know if you know this, but if you want to Google it, it's custom UVs. This is something Unreal supports. You can calculate stuff per vertex and not per pixel. And this is often good enough and helps you with performance, because if you look here, here's the pixel shader and the vertex shader, and if you calculate everything in the pixel shader, you see that now the pixel shader is here, and the vertex shader got a little bit more relaxed because we don't do too much in the vertex shader anymore, but the pixel shader got pretty much, can switch a little bit. You see also the color change, right? And since there are way more pixels on the screen than vertices, if you can do it in the vertex shader, do it in the vertex shader. so custom UVs. Okay, and I talked about this in the talk from last year, how we did these foam thingies. I just wanted to mention that those are manually created. Okay, it's just a material for our little foam, and it's all manually. It's nothing fancy, advanced, dynamically created foam meshes or something. I think nowadays you can use distance field for something like this, but we did not back then. So, okay. And now let's go more into the detail, the caustics. So the caustics are basically, you know the thrill, right? This is UV distortion, like we saw in the fire before, just a little noise texture, distorting this this really nice caustics texture. Also, by the way, I really like, it's a really nice detail, but this is not a grayscale texture, right? I don't know if you can see it. It has greenish and reddish points here. It's like, how's it called? When you distort the separate color channels, it's it's chromatical aberration or chromatic aberration, yeah, and it's a really nice detail here in these in this texture, yeah. So you just distort it, and then you you project it from all the sides, like tree planar mapping, if you want to Google it, right? You just make sure that even without any UV mapping, you can project it to any object you just put in the water. So, and this is how it looks, basically. And here's an example. I hope you can see this. But as soon as the little stone touches the water, it has this little nice caustics on it. You can move it around. Can scale it, everything works. And also on the ground, you have these, right? Everything below the water. So everything below the water, how would you know what's in the water and what's not? That's made by a nice mask, which is based on the absolute world position. And the good thing is that below zero, everything is below zero. And if you represent these coordinates in colors, everything is below zero is black. And if you invert it and clamp it, then suddenly everything below zero is white, as you can see. And since the water plane is not at 0, 0, 0 in the scene, but a little bit higher, I think, Pablo added this little parameter where you could just adjust it a little bit. And with that, you make sure that only the parts of an object that touch the water and are actually below the water get these little caustics applied on. Yeah, that's here again, little caustics. So let's talk about the red sand. This is actually easier. And almost the same thing. Like, here's the red sand again. And actually, it's pretty much the same. As you can see here again, this is again a little world-based mask, right? And this time it colorizes everything below a certain threshold with this color, and this gets multiplied with the actual sand color, and with that you can colorize the sand, right? So and the only difference is that you use a little sine curve to make it move up and down, and then you have this. So pretty simple, but I really like the attention to detail. I could imagine that it's easy to forget something like this, and I really like that they implemented it. Really cool. And now let's talk about the vertex offset, like pushing the vertices around. I would like to explain more details, but to be honest, I don't know too much about it. But what you see here is basically Gerstner waves. Did any one of you guys heard about this before? Yeah? Okay, if you want to deal with water at one point, I guess you will stumble upon these. And I looked at the material, and you get these interesting patterns, and the end result is something like this, right? They get mixed up a little bit, and then you end up with something like this. And it's not only that you get really nice wobbly motion into this. Important and one of the biggest difference about these Gerstner waves is that you can see this on the color. You can move the vertices not only up and down, you can move them forward and backward. That's the big difference. The waves don't do just this, they also do... You will see it just here. Okay, look at this GIF. Here you see how the vertices move, actually, right? And not going just up and down, which they would do when you're just using grayscale map, but with these Gerstner implementations, Gerstner, I hope I pronounce it correctly, it's just way better. Yeah. And also interesting, if you dealt with vertex shaders, which deform objects, you maybe notice that the normals don't get updated. And then usually you have the DDY, DDX approach to recalculate the normals, but then you get these little artifacts. And Pablo found another way. So what he's doing, he's out of a black and white version of these Gerstner waves, he's recreating some normals for his surface, which is actually kind of important, because without it looks like this. Yeah? Here you see the sky, and the sky doesn't really care about the deformation of the water. Even though there are waves, the sky says, I don't know about it. But when you update the normals, it looks like this, right? Suddenly, the reflection reacts to it. And Pablo mentioned this to me. He didn't invent these Gerstner algorithms or something like that. He just, you know, Google do things and then it works. And so Sean mentioned. Okay, so we have these nice things, and then we have a detail normal map, which is, I think it's several normal maps like mixed together and moved over the surface, and then you get some really nice detail to it, and then you have nice reflections. Okay, and now one of the most important parts is the color of the water. This is the basis where all starts. It's a little lookup table. And you wonder what drives this little lookup table. And it's the distance. And this is really interesting to me. I really like this. So you see this little network here. And basically what it does, it calculates the distance between the camera and the pixel of the water and returns a black and white or grayscale value. And together with this little parameter, you can change the appearance, but the basic idea is distance, white, and where you stay is basically dark or black or something. And when you use these grayscale values as an input, as UVs, for your little lookup table, then it looks no. Oh yeah, yeah here. Mm-hmm. Then it looks like this. So you have a color gradient based on the distance on your water as a little base color, which is really nice. You see me fiddling around with that. We don't use the purple orange gradient, but I found it better for the demonstration. So this is a nice foundation for the colors. And the next thing, yeah, you don't see too much anymore, but there's another color which gets multiplied with that, just in case you want to tweak the color a little bit without changing the texture. And then, again, our little daylight intensity material parameter collection comes into play, because as you can see here, the water is unlit material. Again, to save performance, yeah, and if you don't do anything, then your water stays at the same brightness all the time and almost looks a bit glowy at the night. And to make it go darker, you see, we just multiply some day intensity into the material, and then it reacts to the day. Then again, this distance mask is used to change the colors in the distance, just in case you want to tweak a little bit the colors, but only in the distance where the horizon is, you can do this. And now it gets more interesting. We have same for the stuff which is near to you, but this time it's not driven by a distance value. It's driven by, again, a depth fade and also a Fresnel, which means where the water is really near to the sand below, it gets tinted by this color, basically. And in case you don't know what Fresnel is, it's like when the surface is, when you use the Fresnel node, you get values between 0 and 1 again. And this means the more a surface is looking at you, the darker it gets, right? And you can use this for really nice effects. For example, for something like this, right? These areas here are less narrow when you look at them in the viewing angle, your viewing angle to these areas here. Are wider than those at the horizon, and therefore, to the horizon, it fades to white. And you can, Fresnel, it's amazing. that's how it works. And this is the depth fade mask. As you can see, where surfaces are really near to each other, it gets darker, and everything else is white. And these both masks together are important, because if you use only the depth fade to drive the colors, then you see, especially here, I mean, right now it looks okay, but it looks better now. Now the Fresnel mask is added to that, and it covers a little bit better this stone. And also there in the back you see some artifacts, and this Fresnel mask will get important again later, but you can, the combination of both is important here. And here's another example. If you only use the depth fade mask for masking the colors, then it looks like this. And when you use an additional Fresnel mask for this, you can cut out this little artifact there. And I like it more. I hope you too. And something else is interesting. As you can see here, we have some intersections. So there's no opacity applied. But it looks like there's opacity because we see stuff which is below the water. So how is this possible? Just as an example, if you just would use one color for the blue color and one greenish color, and would just lerp between based on the depth fade and the Fresnel, it would look like this. And this is not exactly what we want, right? We could apply some opacity. Like here, you see the opacity. The opacity of the water is just driven by depth fade mask, nothing more special. But you can see that already here, the water is not really translucent anymore. You don't see too much. And yeah, here's a good example. You don't see too much. But at least here, this intersection, right, is gone. Yeah. Okay, but still doesn't look good. You can now reduce the global opacity of the water. And this looks more of what we want, but only if you not compare it to how it actually looks, because this is how the water actually looks, and it's way more vibrant, way more saturated colors. And this is my test version, and it's just a bit dull. So the question is, how is it done? How did Pablo make a better use of the colors. And there, some really nice little note comes into play. It's called scene color. And I couldn't find too much information about it, but let's say my assumption is that this is what you get out of it. And my suggestion would be that this is based on deferred rendering, where all the transparent objects are rendered last, so the non-transparent objects are rendered first, and this is what you get. Is that the truth? Can someone not? Is this the truth? Yeah. Okay, cool. So you get this. You get a rendering of all the objects which are non-translucent, which are below the water. This is a nice base, huh? And now you can tint that. And now you put this, like this color information, imagine it like, let's imagine it would be a texture, you put it on the water, you use this as your color base on the water, and not just one color, right? And with that, it looks way better, I would say. Way more vibrant colors. Ah, now it's complicated. Imagine in Photoshop you would create two layers which get blended later. This is what Pablo is doing in the material now. So we are there, we will now create two different things and then merge them together by screen blending them. So the first thing is, there's a thing called fake daylight, another color multiplication is happening here. And the other branch, the other layer, you could say, is the day intensity gets taken again, and now it gets more important. The cube map gets added. And again, with a Fresnel mask, if you just add the cube map to the whole water, it looks like this. Yeah, maybe it's a bit too much, right? But if you make sure that only where the viewing angles are more narrow, then it looks like this. Then I guess this is called total reflection, right? This is what we learned in physics course in school. So here again, this one. Oh, and then this is a bit hard to see. These little fake reflections here, these little guys, gets added. These little glittering glitties. And at the end, both of those layers basically get screen blend together, and then it looks like this. Still, we have the harsh cut. No problem. Depth, fade, opacity mask. Boom. Rime water. This is slightly more complicated than what I suggested in my first little material, right? But it's worth the effort, I guess. And one thing, there is a standard Unreal height fog in the scene to make a little fade in the distance. Nothing special there, just a cool height fog from Unreal. Yeah. Speaking about these little fake reflections, those are interesting because I'm not 100% sure. I think there was a problem back then with having these reflections, translucent materials with such reflections. There was just a problem or something like that. So another little fake came into the play. And here is like old school stuff, how you could do something like this. I love something like this, right? You have this mask and then you just move another twirly texture below it, and then you get these little, if you ignore everything and just look here on this plane, it looks like these little sparkles on water, right? And another thing here, this is the texture which drives it, and then you get out here these little river glitties. Let's call them glitties. But this is not how it's done. What Pablo was doing is he's using a normal map, takes out the red channel twice, and takes a dot product, and then it looks like this. It's already interesting. I just put the notes here. You don't have to read them. It's just he's fiddling around, right? This is what this short see, and you get more details about this on the blog later below the talk, right? It gets pushed a little bit more, and then he fiddles around a little bit more, and then it looks like this. And this is already something that goes into a direction of these reflections, right? You would expect on water. But that's not where he's stopping. He's using another normal map, differently panning and moving these separated channels. Another one adds them together, takes both of those, makes a dot product, and pushes the values a little bit more. And this is what comes out of this. Looks even nicer than before, not as intense, yeah? And that's not everything. He's still doing something, and this is also interesting. I was always wondering what this does, right? If you played around with absolute world position, including material offset, excluding material offset, whatever this means. And now I got it. It's the one position is without, when you push the vertices around, right? And the one is with this difference, and the other one is without these differences. And what he's doing, he's calculating the differences between the plane, which was not modified, and the modified plane. And with that, he can create a mask, which basically tells him where is water moving, where is a wave right now. And this is the mask for these little reflections. And you can see this, right? I play it faster here, so you can see the wave moving through. So this gives you a little bit more variation on the water. Yeah. And there you see them. Yeah, here you see these little reflections again. Okay, and then there's another one. This is interesting. I don't have too much detail about it, but he has another one, which, and they are always visible, but only if you look in a certain direction. And those were important for making something like this, like the reflection from the sun and the moon. And the position of the sun and the moon get fed into the shader, into the material, and then he can react to it in the material. So this adds a lot to it during night and day. Okay, so now we have nice colors, and we need some nice refractions. When I activated, when I just put in the normals in the material and then activated refraction by putting in a value of 103, like the standard water index of refraction, right? Then it looks like this. It's not exactly what we wanted. So Pablo came up with interesting ideas to mask the reflection only where you want to have it. And the first thing is a distance mask. And we saw this before with the lookup texture for the colors, right? Here I showed when you move around, it stays where you are, basically. And this mask is used to tell, hey, make refraction only where I am, okay? And the second mask is, again, a Fresnel mask. You see that, right? That, like, depending on the viewing angle on the surfaces, the black and white color changes. And both are used to control the refraction a little bit more. Which means here you see the distance mask is activated, and you still see the little double foam rings in the foreground, but at least the background is now a little bit more cleaned out and is not refracted anymore. And and here's an example when you don't have this. No, here's on. This is with this distance mask on, and here is off. And you see, especially here, you see these artifacts also here, right? I mean, artifacts, it's like it's supposed to be, but it doesn't look super nice. It looks a bit noisy in the distance. So this distance mark helps to, disable these things. And here's how you use the Fresnel mask. Yeah, the Fresnel mask lets you control the even near distance, like, and then you can mask out these artifacts there with the double foam rings. And still you get some of the distortion here. You see it here, but it's, to be honest, it's not that strong. And some people would have said, good enough, but not Pablo. Pablo said, no, I want to have another mask. And this is another mask. This is based on the little detail normals we saw before. And I think it's also another dot product and some magic happening there. But the end result is this. And this drives via lerp, basically, between a value of 1 and 103, the index of refraction again. So these areas have no refraction, these areas have refraction, and when you use this, then you get way better refraction. It looks so much better, there's more going on, and you also see some almost like little waves pushing through the water. And this is not based on the original normals, actually. I think when I tested with and without the activating normals in the material, I didn't see too much difference, to be honest. The refractions were still working fine. So, yeah, all in all, this is really nice. If you want more details, I will put it on my blog, like I said there. Then yeah, thanks for listening and wish you a nice day.